Good afternoon to everybody. It's just a brief presentation of technology that we are developing in the last 10 years. And we believe it's going to be a possible option among all of the other for small satellites. So our work is centered in what is normally known as helicon technology. We started at the University of Padua, Center of Studies and Activities for Space, which is as a center in the University of Padua, which is, was really focused on space activity. The center participated to several missions from NASA, NASA, and from European space agencies, exploration mission as Rosetta, Cassini Huygens, Mars Express, and so on. And in that environment, this research had started and has been developed for years. Then later on, we established a spin-off, which was really focused on bringing the knowledge acquired in the university environment and put into the market on in order to exploit the, what has been created in several years. The topics are electric propulsion, chemical propulsion, small rockets, and some innovative antenna based on plasma elements. However, we still have in the spin-off environment some research and development activities. Regarding electric propulsion, we're already targeting the first product. So this is the team. Most of it is belong to the spin-off, just four PhD and myself, we still belong to university. And all of us are really focused on space propulsion. So, what is the helicon technology? Helicon was really established in the past for industrial application, and it is well known because it is able to provide high density. So people started to propose it to use it as a thruster because it was really able to efficiently ionize gases. So an helicon thruster is really based on this technology, of course, with some significant modification. So the structure is very simple. It's just a tube made by the electric material surrounded by an antenna and surrounded by a suitable magnetic generator. As you see, you don't have cathodes, you don't have electrodes inside, you don't have plates. So it's by itself, it's neutral. It doesn't need a neutralization system. So one of the main issues is long lifetime and low cost because of its intrinsic simplicity. So if you just use an operational scheme, you have that the power is coupled to the plasma by an antenna. Then you have a magnetic nozzle which takes care about the plasma acceleration into vacuum. You have a feeding line, and basically that's it. So generally speaking, it's a very, from the engineering point of view, it's a very simple engine. So, coming back to what are the key features, why we like it? Well, no electrodes, no cathodes, no neutralization grid. Again, it means lifetime is not an issue, but also, respect to ion engine, for example. Ion engine are beautiful machine, very high performance. This is lower performance, of course, but from the engineering point of view, it's very simple. So, very few pieces to assemble together. On the other side, the physics is more complicated because you don't have really generation stage, you don't have an acceleration stage, you have everything mixed together. So naturally, always all the metals have to face. How it's done, if you understand the physics, you can really scale it up and down. So you can really customize the customer requirements very easily. So it's something that some other thrusters don't have this capability. This is really easy to configure, to change the configuration. It's kind of versatile in the sense that it can use basically whatever gas you put in. Of course, performances are not the same, but it doesn't get destroyed by anything because it's gas just get in touch with the electric material. Then, so you don't have electrodes and grids, so you can really eat everything. Then it's throttable. And then finally, what we are developing is a propulsion box. So we are trying to put into the market a system which is plug and play as far as possible with the platform. So what does it make possible? Well, but this is the main one. So high delta V mission, so high total impulse mission. So we are talking about, for example, drag compensation or end of life disposal exploration mission. But in these days, we are talking about a future exploration mission. So it is also worth it, I believe, to put the attention on the kind of new mission that may become interesting in the future, let's say 10 years from now. So wherever you believe you can use some in situ propellant provided by a major mother spacecraft or find in situ on a planetary atmosphere or on rocks or whatsoever, well, this system may be interesting. That was the outcome of an ESA program where we analyzed what this system can provide more. So, of course, the first one is high delta V mission for small satellite. The reason is low cost. But the second part is enabling technology for when you have some type of gas and you'd like to use it, as the example that I mentioned. So atmospheric breathing is a kind of possibility. And you don't care if what you breathe is kind of dangerous or corrosive or stuff like that. The engine doesn't care. Of course, the other part of a spacecraft may care more. But the engine itself is really robust. So looking into the future, this type of thruster will open some possibilities that may be taken by explorators. The development program started in 2007 through some code. Then in 2009, we started a major European program, which was named HPH.com, which we leaded, and which was really focused on developing being a prototype. It was a consortium of 13 partners around Europe, and several laboratory models being developed, mainly University of Padua and in Ukraine. Then, at the end of this program, we established we understand much more the physics of this system. We developed several codes in order to simulate. Again, it's a complicated physics, so you need a blend of code in order to analyze the different aspects. And then we end up with the first prototype, which is this one. It's a 50 watt motor. It's rather big, as you can see. It's 120 millimeter in diameter and 157 millimeter in length. So it's a kind of big for a 50 watt motor. Of course, it's compatible with a 50 kilogram platform and not with the CubeSat itself. But then it was 2012. When we went on with the development, and the focus was how to reduce the size in order to make it compatible with much more the platform. So the effort was mainly taken by the spin-off. However, the university went on with other researches toward high power. The spin-off took over the development on small platform. And that was the result of the development. So it's a system which can stay in a hand. So it's really small and can fit inside of a CubeSat. So all of the research were toward miniaturization of a component. Of course, you need to find some compromise. So as soon as you go to smaller dimension, everything becomes more critical, efficiency go lower. So keep the same efficiency as below as a bigger motor with a smaller one. Then we see how it would look like as inside of our CubeSat. Can we build up a unit or similar unit with everything inside? So the black part are the PPU, the power processing unit. Then you see a server, fluidic equipment, and so on. And at the center, you see the thruster. Everything inside, very simple interface, plug and play. Following CubeSat standard. That's exactly what we are developing now. PPU, power processing unit, is a key factor. We had to develop inside. This is a laboratory model we are going on. Of course, we already have done also the analyze all of the aspects for the design, for the space qualification design, analyzed all of the components. Is it really a critical point, because 50% of the cost, or even more, is related to PPU, and if you don't satisfy it, it's gonna be critical. And again, and also the PPU really has to merge with the thruster, so that's why the development has been done inside. The model was deeply characterized with the thrust on board the thrust balance in our department to analyze both how thrust scale with power and also ISP scale with power. And then we see how does it would look like, a 6-unit. As this was a program for space observation. A 6-unit space observation CubeSat with at the center our motor. Then you can see different maneuvers. This is, for example, this is an example of different maneuver that you can do around the moon or going to the moon. So it looks that, of course, the size of the unit, if you want to go to the moon, you cannot be just a 6-year unit. Of course, it depends on the delta V, but what it looks like is that you can get really a lot of maneuverability with this engine, doing a lot of things around your planet or in deep space. Now we are in the full part of engineering, of the development of the engineering model. Currently, we have it's fully covered by internal funding. So till qualification, it's fully covered by internal funding. Now we are discussing about flight in 2018 and 2018. We have several options, but that's exactly what we are doing in these days. So we believe a mini helicon represents a viable solution in order to provide a maneuverability, a low cost maneuverability option to small platform, starting from multiple U to about 50-60 kilograms platform. The development program is ongoing and we are looking forward to flying soon. Thanks for the attention.
Any questions?
Hi. One question about this helicon propulsion system. What are the figures of delta V that you can provide for one U cluster? You have one U unit, which is the
No, it really depends. I mean, delta V, it's based on the amount, it depends on the amount of propellant that you can put on board. So, for example, this is was done with 8 kilograms dry mass and then 60 watt power. So, it really depends. I mean, you can get any type of delta V based on the type of payload you put on. Let's say, but if you have in mind that a single unit is for the motor, second unit is for the bus, and then you have a payload, so you have to consider at least a 3-unit. The amount of considering the propellant that can stay in this kind of stuff is on the order of 100 of megapercent.
Thanks.
But of course, it depends on the very
Just wondering, have you done AMC testing?
Not yet. That's one point that we have to. We have defined a plan how to do AMC testing, and also we have analyzed how to ship. So at the moment, we have done numerical analysis in order to see what is the emitted electromagnetic field considering the shielding. We didn't do already the MC testing, it's planned to be done.
Yeah, there might be some interesting opportunity actually for combining EMC shielding with radiation shielding.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, that's a good
point.
Stuff,
sure.
Also because there is also a magnetic shielding. So yeah, that's all together, absolutely.
Just one comment on that. Actually, I'm doing radiation effects, and they very recently published some work on actually radiation-induced changes of EMC problems. So maybe there might be something related to it.
Okay, thanks for the suggestion.
Any further questions? Okay, let's thank you for speaking then.